folks. Welcome to the Irish Sea. Anyway, I thought I'd make a video about non-duality and talk about the process that I have went through and what non-duality means to me in comparison to what it meant to me some years ago. Because this is not something that is easily graspable all at once. And it started off for me with the understanding that there was a universal mind of which my mind was some kind of expression. So it felt like there was little me down here and there was big me upstairs that was running the whole show and that was aware of everything. It was aware of all the little individual minds of people and of animals, and was also somehow aware of, you know, even rocks and things. Like it was somehow projecting all of this. And I didn't realize it at the time, but in thinking along those lines, I was guilty of a lingering monotheism. You know, you were still picturing the ground of being, the infinite, as some kind of human-like personality. when really, if you thought about evolution, we weren't always like this. You know, a long, long time ago, we were nothing more than these little tube-like things that scurried along and took in nutrients from the front and excreted them out the back. And then we eventually grew all sorts of appendages along ourselves that, you know, eventually composed the bodies that we now have. But we still have that same basic structure of, you know, in goes the fuel at one end, it's processed, and out it comes at the other end. And the thing that we call a brain that houses our mind, I don't know that that's really the center of us. The center of us could well be thought to be the stomach. But the brain is like a big appendage that simply allows this huge organism to function correctly in this sort of environment that we live. So it's kind of wrong to think of this universal mind that is very human-like. So anyway, that was that lingering monotheism. And then, of course, you're thinking as well that, you know, you're asking yourself, what is consciousness? And you understand that there's something metaphysical at the root of it, something that you can't break down into smaller parts. And you realize that the scientific community is undergoing a kind of a pretense, almost, that they understand exactly what the mind is. They certainly understand parts of it, but there is something at the core of mind that is very, very strange. So then, you know, the other vector that you look at is the physical universe. What is it? And the more you look at it, the more it starts to become something like an illusion. You know, even if you take that very scientific route and get to grips with quantum physics, everything is no longer particles, it's waves, it's interconnected in some way. Everything falls away to being somehow illusory. And we think of visible light as this tiny, tiny little part of the electromagnetic spectrum. So if this environment is like an illusion, we tend to think that we have to somehow reach some other state of consciousness that takes us out of the illusion. That seems like the natural direction to go in. But I've since come to realize that that's wrong. And we'll come to that in a minute. So then, you think, you know, you're asking yourself questions like, where do I go when I die? And you start to think, well, I must reconnect with that universal consciousness, that universal mind. You know, when I was born, I left it. I became isolate. And when I die, I return to it, I become one with it again. But then, you start to try to wrap your head around the question of what is time? And you come to the conclusion that time isn't something that's actually real. There is one moment that we call now, and everything flows around that moment. The present is not something that's continually escaping us. The past is not something that has any actual existence, nor is the future. It's just a projection of our hopes and fears. There is only one thing that is real, this moment. And this moment has always been and will always be. And all that time is just a measure of change. That's all it is. So, if there's just this one moment, I didn't really come from anywhere and I'm not going to anywhere. Eternity is not the future, eternity is now. So, yes, in terms of the experience of the progress of time, I will be born and I will die. But if there is no time, then I am that universal consciousness right now. I never left it, I will never return to it, I am it. There is only this one moment, now. So, that adds quite a different spin on the idea of, well, where do we go when we die? Because if it's simply a case of this body and mind dying, I don't have to return to something. It's, you know, I'm already there. I am that universal consciousness focused into this little limited awareness down here. So, is there anything actually to try to get back to? Well, I still have that lingering sense that there's a presence above Maya, above the world of form, that is orchestrating everything. But again, there's that lingering monotheism. So when I started to really get to grips with this idea, well, what is this? What is the infinite? What is the ground of being? And of course, I defined it as it's formless, it's timeless. And then I really started to look at what those words actually implied. To say that something is formless is to say that it is nothing at all. If it does not have form, it is nothing. Now, it is also paradoxically everything, because everything comes out of it. But we have to take account of the fact that somehow it is also nothing. And to say that it is timeless means that it is outside of time, presiding over time, if you like. All moments coalesce into this one moment. But if it's formless, what is it? It's nothing at all. And this is where I kind of had this educated guess, I suppose, in that it's very hard to express, but it's like some people try to talk about the infinite, and they would call it infinite love. And that, I suppose, has some merit, because oneness and love seem to be the same thing. Togetherness, oneness. But I think it's also true that we can think of the infinite as chaos, because it is formless. And formlessness is chaos. It is nothing. So this is why I've come to this educated guess that's why there is duality. That's why there is a universe of form that undergoes change and appears to move through time. Because if there wasn't this form, if there wasn't this duality, then non-duality, the ground of being, would have no existence at all. It wouldn't mean anything. Only through dualistic expression does the ground of being become anything at all. So, this is very deep stuff. And some people are probably going, well. But anyway. So, with that in place, that's where I suddenly have this very different perspective on Maya, on the world of form as illusion. Because if I get out of this illusion, what is there to go back to? Chaos, formlessness. The ground of being is nothing at all without this. And that's where you come to realize, finally, that you're home. Right here, you are home. There's nothing to return to. There's nothing to reconnect with. And this is where I think some non-dualists, they get caught up in the pursuit of mystical experience. And yes, you can have mystical experiences of one kind or another, and I've had them myself, but I've never allowed myself to get too caught up in them, because now I realize that this is it, right here. You are the infinite, right here, right now, in the only moment that really exists, right now. There's nothing to get back to except formlessness. And if you do try to have some mystical experience where you somehow reconnect with the infinite, reconnect with that non-dual ground of being, that's impossible, because it's always going to be you experiencing the infinite. So that's not one, that's two. That's duality. The only way to experience non-duality is to not exist. In other words, to die. But non-duality is nothing at all, because it's formlessness. So you have to be born and experience this life. So I'm kind of getting at this notion that you've arrived, you're here. Live your life. Stop trying to escape from this life, because this is nirvana, if you like. Maya is nirvana. There's nothing else to find but, you know, the joys and sorrows and all of the color of life's experience right here. So maybe that gives some of you, particularly you who resonate with non-duality, maybe that gives you a little something to think about. It's kind of like a path that you start on and you don't fully understand it. And it takes a few years even to get down to the other end of it. And I don't really know that I'm at the other end of it yet, because I keep learning new things. This keeps on getting subtler and subtler. but it's a lot of fun, I gotta say. I never had this much stimulation through Christian spirituality, that's for sure. But I don't want to make this another anti-Christian video. I've made enough of those. So, stop trying to escape from your life. It strikes me that the pursuit of mystical experience, in the way that maybe Eckhart Tolle presents it, you know, he's always talking about how we have to, what's the word I'm looking for, you know, he emphasizes finding this bliss, this stillness, by being present in the now. Here's the thing, you can't be anything but present in the now. What time is it right now? It's now. You're here, in the now. Regardless of how angry you feel, how afraid you feel, or whatever, the now is always there. It's not something you need to connect to. And feelings of bliss, I guess they're fine if you want those for a while, but life was meant to have a great deal more vitality and color than that. And I would not want to be spending my days trying to connect with that, when there's a whole lot more things, vastly more interesting, that I could be doing with my life. So, just some thoughts.